Hey guys, ever wanted to make an awesome Hypersomnia map like the official ones? Today, Lopa will get you through the basics of the editor.
When you open the game, you will see a screen like this one. Here you should select Editor from the menu on the bottom left. Now you are in something called Project Selector. This is the place where you will be able to see all the maps you've created. For me, now it's empty. You can also see the official arenas as well as downloaded arenas, which you can get from the map catalog or by playing on any servers. This menu allows you to create copies of those maps, so you can see them in editor view and maybe even create your own versions of them. However, I want to make a map from scratch, so I will click on the Create New Arena button. In this window pop-up, you need to choose a name for your project. The name of the map should contain only lowercase characters, numbers, or underscores. You can also enter a short description, but that can also be done later. When you're ready, simply click on Create. Now you will enter the editor view, but what also happened is that the game created a folder for your new project. That folder can be found in game directory /user/projects, and there is a folder of the name of the map you selected. In this folder, you can find a JSON file with the name of the map you've selected as a project, then the editor view, and sometimes also autosave. If you want to use any custom graphics or sounds to create a map, this is also where you should store them, but we'll get to that later. Alright, now that we are in the actual editor, I will show you some panes or sections, whatever you want to call them, and try to briefly explain what they do. Okay, so first, the big empty space in the middle is called Scene. This is your work area, and this is where you will be doing most of the work, designing the map and the layout using resources. Now, the resources panel is kind of a library for all the assets you can use to create a map. This can be walls, floors, obstacles, decorations, anything you like. And you simply drag the resource from this panel onto the scene. Once you drag and drop a resource onto the scene, you will create a node. It's basically a single instance of a resource being used somewhere on the scene. And how is it different? Well, technically, you can use the same resource multiple times, or you cannot use it at all. Above resources, we have a section called layers. This is where you can group your nodes as well as determine the display order. So if, for instance, you want the walls or decorations to be displayed above floors, you will just need to arrange them in the right order. Even if it sounds a little bit confusing right now, don't worry. Once I show the examples, it will be extremely simple. Now on the right, we have the inspector. This is where you can change properties of nodes and resources such as size, position, visuals, and physics. In bottom right, you have a section called history, which tracks the actions you've taken. And if you press undo, so usually Ctrl Z, it will undo the latest one. And finally, at the top, we have the toolbar. This is where you can find tools to work on nodes such as resize, move, rotate, or clone. You can hover over each icon to see the keybind, which will make your work much easier and faster. You can also move this toolbar to a different position. There is also the title bar in the top left. This is where you can open the folder with your project, access project settings. Here you can also open or close any of the UI panels. The last thing about the UI is that you can resize the panels on the sides. Okay, now that you're familiar with the UI, I'm going to show you how to import custom resources into your project. First, you're going to need to open the folder with the map, which you can do either here or here. Now you should see a folder with one or two JSON files. Just like with map names, there are some limitations to what you can put in the file names, but in this case you don't need to worry because the editor will change the name of the file for you. I prepared a folder with a few graphics which have forbidden characters and file names. Now, in order to import them, I just copy and paste the entire folder into the map directory. Subfolder structure will also be reflected in the editor. When the editor is open, the game scans for new or missing resources each time you alt-tab back into the game. I'm getting prompts about invalid folder and file names, so I just click rename for all of them. And there we go. Resources are now added to the editor, and I can start making my map with them. Now, I want my map to have a grass floor, so I drag and drop it onto the scene, and there we go. I just created a node. Now, since this resource was originally 64 by 64 pixels, this is also the size of the node, so it's quite small. So now I'm going to press Ctrl E to resize it by two edges. Now I want to move this grass a little bit to the left, so I'm going to press T and move it right here. When you're making a map, you will be moving around your scene a lot, so you need to remember you can zoom out or in using your mouse wheel. You can change camera position by holding right mouse button or using arrow keys. Now I'm going to clone this patch of grass, and you can do that by clicking on the node and pressing C. Now we're gonna build a wall around this patch of grass, so I will use the brick, resize it, clone it, and now there are two horizontal walls. And then to make vertical walls, you could either drag and drop bricks onto the scene again and resize them, but this time resize them vertically. But since I am lazy, I will just clone this horizontal wall and use the rotate function, and then create a clone of it on the opposite side. In order to fill in the corner, the node will have to be a bit longer. Keep in mind that if you use that approach, the graphics will also be rotated, so in this case, the bricks will not be aligned. Right, now I have all my nodes in layer 1, and I would like to move all the bricks into a new layer. So here's how I can do that. So first I need to select my nodes, so I click on the first one that I want to select, and then while holding shift I click on the last one. Or you can also press Ctrl and click on each one individually. And then I drag my selection onto the plus icon, which will both create a layer and reassign all these nodes to it. Now that walls and floors are separate, I want to keep it nice and tidy, so I will select the layer and press F2 to rename it. In this case it might seem unnecessary, but it is very helpful when you have a bigger map. For example, this is the grouping of layers on one of the official maps. Now let's talk about the inspector. This panel allows you to make changes to selected nodes, resources, or layers. You can change properties of multiple objects selected as long as they are the same type. So for instance, three resources, but not one layer and two resources. When you select a node, the editor will automatically select the resource assigned to this node as well. So you will see one tab for node properties and one tab for resource properties. In the node tab, you set up the basics such as position, size, rotation. While in resources tab, you configure a bit more advanced settings such as physics. To be honest, the resources tab is way more interesting, and I'll show you why in a second. But before that, I mentioned earlier that when you change settings on a resource, it will be applied to all nodes based on this resource. So here's what it means. If I set this resource to rotate continuously, despite the fact that I have one node selected, all of the walls start spinning. You might have noticed that I was using a small sprite for the grass patch. It was only 64 by 64 pixels. And when I resized the node, it created a larger rectangle made of smaller tiles. If you don't want these tiles, you can tick an option Stretch when resized on Resource tab. But once again, keep in mind that this is something that will be applicable to all nodes using that specific resource. Now I will show you one interesting feature about layers. So first off, you can toggle visibility of all the nodes assigned to a layer by clicking the eye icon next to it. And now another thing. By default, you can select multiple nodes on the scene, and then you can move them. But what if I only wanted to move the walls? In that case, layers have a flag called selectable on scene. And what it does is that you can still see the nodes and they will still be there on the map. But when you try to select multiple nodes with your cursor, it will just ignore the nodes that belong to this layer. Alright, now that we have a simple map, it's time to add some obstacles. I mentioned earlier that apart from your own resources, there are also official ones, and here is where you can find them. I'm looking for a crate, so I will just type that into the search bar and drag it onto the scene. Okay, now it's time to playtest the map. You can do it by pressing space or the play icon on the toolbar. For quick test mode, player character will start in the center of the current scene view. So, it looks like I can walk on the grass, but I can also walk through the brick walls, which were meant to be obstacles. In order to change that, we're going to have to assign resources to domains. You can do that in the Resource tab in the Inspector. We have three domains: background, physical, and foreground. Background is the default one, and as you've seen, it does not interact with characters or projectiles, and it is displayed below other domains. So, for example, the grass patch that we have here. Now the second domain is the foreground. It's pretty similar to background, except it will be displayed above everything else, including your character. It can be used for decorations, hiding spots, or in some cases to show directions on where to go. And now to show you the difference, here is how the character will interact with background node, and here is the foreground node. Finally, we have the physical domain. This is where you will define nodes which will interact with characters, weapons, projectiles, basically all the fun stuff. Physical domain has many flags and attributes which can be adjusted, so you'll need to experiment with some of them. But the flags should be pretty self-explanatory. So now I have my wall selected, and I'm gonna tick the immovable flag. And let's playtest. Now that the walls are physical and immovable, I can no longer walk through them. Here you can also choose the material which the resource is made from, which will change physics and the sound on impact. Now a bit of a different example. I'm gonna take this vending machine and change the material to glass, but I will not select the immovable flag, and let's see what happens. Because the material I used was glass, when I shoot the vending machine at an angle, the bullets will ricochet. And what if I wanted to build glass walls? Well, I just select the see-through flag. If you experiment with the physics settings, you can get some interesting results. Now I'm gonna show you one additional feature of physical domain, collider shape. Custom resources will always be rectangular, even if your resource has a transparent background. You can customize it by adding custom collider shape, and it will affect both the hitbox and the illumination. See how the shadow corresponds to the shape of the ball. And since I mentioned illumination, let's talk about special resources. You can find them in the official resources tab, and they include things like light sources, pickable weapons, buy zones, bomb sites, spawns, portals, or hazards. You will need to use at least some of them to make playable maps. You can change some attributes on special resources, but it can depend on the specific resource. For instance, for light sources, you can change the color of the light. And for team spawns, you can change which faction will be spawning in that position. A playable map in bomb defusal mode should have at least one team spawn for each faction and a bomb site so that the map objectives can be fulfilled. Buy zones are also pretty important as they determine where you can use the shop at the beginning of the round. But if you want to make a map with only pickable weapons, that's also an option. One thing worth mentioning is that when it comes to official resources, you can change anything on the node tab, but you cannot change any resource properties. We've covered pretty much everything when it comes to designing the map, so now just a few final things left. First, project settings. You can access them right here or by pressing Ctrl and U. In project settings, you can edit the default game mode, warm-up theme, change playtest settings, or adjust the ambient light on the whole map. You can also add a description to your project. And then we also have the game mode settings, and these can be found in the resources tab. Here you can change things like number of rounds needed to win the whole game, warm-up time, freeze time, also the equipment that players will get at the beginning of the round. And now the last thing, in game settings you can change some of the things about how the editor works. This has to do with the time to autosave and also what to do in case the autosave is newer than the manual save. Again, I recommend experimenting and seeing if there is anything that interests you. Now that you know how to use the Hypersomnia map editor, go forth and create the greatest map ever known to man. Seek strength, the rest will follow.